In 1988, in Berkeley, California, a man named Mark, who had been affected by polio since the age of 6, experienced total paralysis. Due to his condition, Mark was forced to spend the rest of his life with the help of a negative pressure ventilator. Despite this, his passion and ambition to become a writer and poet never faded. Mark remained determined, using his illness as motivation to continue learning until he eventually graduated from university. In this film, we will be presented with the humorous side of Mark's life journey, along with many valuable lessons. Let's dive straight into the story. One morning, as Mark woke up from his sleep, a nurse who usually took care of him arrived. The nurse's name was Joan. As usual, Joan helped Mark by cleaning him and feeding him. That morning, Joan took Mark with his hospital bed to a church. At this church, we meet a priest we'll call Father Brendan. Mark came to the church to complain to Father Brendan about his nurse, Joan, who he felt always took advantage of his condition and often belittled him. Father Brendan said that if Mark felt uncomfortable, it was understandable if Mark wanted to fire Joan. Elsewhere, a beautiful woman named Amanda was looking at the bulletin board at her campus and found a job flyer from Mark. Amanda then came to Mark's house and tried to apply for the job. However, in Mark's mind, having never experienced closeness with a woman in his 30 years of life, inappropriate thoughts crossed his mind as he noticed Amanda's beauty. Even though Amanda was new to this type of work, it turned out that Amanda was better and more humane than Joan. Occasionally, Amanda would take Mark on picnics together. Due to Amanda's dedication in caring for Mark, her boyfriend felt jealous. However, Amanda explained to her boyfriend that she was just being professional as Mark's personal nurse. The next day, Mark and Amanda visited a clothing store. In the comfortable and warm atmosphere thanks to Amanda's treatment, Mark suddenly expressed his feelings, stating that he had fallen in love with Amanda. However, Amanda gently explained that she already had a boyfriend, indirectly rejecting Mark's feelings. After this declaration, Amanda felt awkward and decided to resign from her job. A few days later, Mark received a new nurse named Vera. In addition to Vera, a man named Rod also joined as a nurse who would be taking care of Mark. After getting acquainted with the new nurses, Mark received a call from a friend offering him an opportunity to get involved in writing an article on worldly pleasures. The article would discuss the lives of people with disabilities in carrying out farming activities, and Mark was asked to interview other people with disabilities. Some time later, Mark went to a woman's house to interview her about her farming experience. Feeling that the interview didn't provide any significant insights, Mark then moved to another location to interview a man. However, the interview with the man also didn't yield satisfactory results. The next day, Mark returned to the church to meet with Father Brendan and shared his difficulties in conducting the interviews. Father Brendan suggested that Mark find a therapist around Berkeley. After hearing Father Brendan's advice, Mark immediately contacted a therapy center. However, Mark found out that the therapy office in the Berkeley area had been closed. The center recommended that Mark contact a therapist named Dr. Laura. A short while later, Mark arrived at Dr. Laura's office. Seeing Mark's condition, Dr. Laura thought for a moment and suggested that Mark undergo therapy. The next day, Mark asked Father Brendan for permission and explained the purpose of the therapy. Mark explained that this therapy was directly related to his activities and that he would be involved in those activities with his therapist. Hearing this explanation, Father Brendan paused to digest Mark's statement. As a priest, Father Brendan couldn't support actions that might go against religious teachings. However, considering Mark's condition and viewing it from a friend's perspective, Father Brendan reluctantly gave his permission. A few days later, the surrogate therapy began. Mark felt very stressed and worried that his therapist might distance herself after seeing his condition. However, Vera tried to calm him down and reminded him not to think negatively. The therapist who would conduct the sessions was a woman named Cheryl. Cheryl explained that her job was different from that of a call girl, and that this therapy consisted of 6 sessions, giving Mark 6 opportunities to engage in the activity. The goal of the therapy was to strengthen Mark's muscles. The first therapy session aimed to train body awareness. Cheryl arrived gracefully and shared stories with Mark. Cheryl began touching Mark's body from head to toe. The basic movements Cheryl performed made Mark feel overwhelmed, so the first session ended very briefly. Cheryl then informed him that in the second session, they would jump straight into a more exciting activity, which made Mark happy as he felt he was close to ending his celibacy. After the session, Cheryl reported Mark's condition to Dr. Laura. It turned out that Cheryl was the wife of a man named Josh. During the second therapy session, there was some significant improvement. Although Mark was still struggling, there was a slight improvement in his physical condition, with better responses when reaching out to more sensitive areas. After the therapy session, Cheryl summarized the results and concluded that Mark still lacked confidence and his mental state was not strong enough to handle his activities. Elsewhere, Mark visited Father Brendan and talked about his two failed therapy sessions. Father Brendan advised Mark to focus on the therapy and try to utilize his romantic side as a writer and poet. Father Brendan suggested that Mark might be able to link the therapy to his creativity to improve the outcomes. In the third therapy session, Mark and Cheryl continued the therapy at a hotel. Upon arrival, Mark was escorted to his room by the hotel receptionist. After Vera left the room, the receptionist inquired about Mark's activities. Vera explained that Mark was undergoing therapy, but the receptionist seemed skeptical until Vera provided further explanation, which made the receptionist somewhat convinced. Back to Mark, in this session, Cheryl guided Mark into his subconscious, asking him to access and express himself as a 6-year-old boy. After the subconscious therapy was completed, it became clear that Mark was starting to show progress, with more positive responses to the activity. Although the progress was still early, Cheryl continued to encourage Mark, emphasizing that he had made significant strides. With therapy time still remaining, they began discussing their daily lives and past experiences to build a closer bond. That night, Father Brendan appeared in disguise as a stylish young man and visited Mark. It seemed his curiosity about Mark's therapy progress led him to witness the process firsthand. Elsewhere, Cheryl contacted Dr. Laura to provide an update on the therapy's progress. It appeared that feelings of affection were beginning to develop between the therapist and the patient. Cheryl seemed happy while talking about Mark, and without hesitation, she confessed to Laura that she felt drawn to Mark because of his uniqueness and character. Love can indeed blossom anywhere, regardless of time or place. However, for those who already have someone who loves them, it's important not to stray. The next day, Mark invited Cheryl for a coffee. Cheryl was pleased that the therapy had successfully boosted Mark's confidence, but she began to feel confused about her own feelings. Cheryl eventually accepted Mark's invitation, and they met at a cafe, where they chatted and laughed together. At night, Mark decided to express his feelings in the form of a poem and send it to Cheryl's house. However, the letter was received by Josh, Cheryl's husband, who was often at home due to his unemployment. Soon after, a heated argument erupted between Josh and Cheryl, with Josh feeling that Cheryl had crossed the line by developing romantic aspects within the therapy, while Cheryl was caught in a dilemma between jealousy and emotional confusion. After her husband fell asleep, Cheryl went out to find Mark's letter. After reading it, Cheryl began to harbor deep feelings of love for her patient, Mark. A few days later, the fourth therapy session arrived. In this session, significant progress was evident. Mark, who had previously struggled, now showed an extraordinary transformation. His physical condition, once weak, had now developed into something stronger, allowing both of them to feel satisfaction from the activities they were engaging in. Cheryl felt proud of the achievement, considering how successful Mark's transformation had been. However, Cheryl announced that this session would be the end of their therapy. Cheryl was starting to feel too comfortable with Mark and worried that her feelings would deepen into something more. That night, Mark felt deeply saddened, feeling abandoned by Cheryl. The situation worsened and a power outage affected Mark's ventilator. In a panic, Mark tried to contact his two nurses and called emergency services, but he soon lost consciousness. Fortunately, when Mark regained consciousness, he found himself in the hospital emergency room, accompanied by a beautiful nurse named Susan. Susan, a volunteer at the hospital, had waited all night to ensure Mark was okay. After talking to Susan and learning that she was unmarried and had a kind demeanor, Mark began to think that Susan might be his soulmate and became determined to marry her. They began to form a close bond and friendship, which leads us 5 years into the future. Mark and Susan eventually got married, but in the 5th year of their marriage, Mark took his last breath. To honor Mark, Susan invited everyone who had played a role in his life. Among the guests were Amanda and Cheryl. The funeral was attended by many, but the most special moment was the gathering of the three women who had loved Mark and a friend who had cared for him deeply. At the end of the funeral, Father Brendan shared Mark's final moments, while Susan read a series of poems written by Mark to commemorate his spirit and life's efforts. And that's our film for today. What do you think? Interesting, isn't it? Don't miss our next video. Thank you.